in the Pentecost season. We begin on page 185 with the words of the grace, which draw us together in this body of Christ. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We say together, Almighty God, to you
all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
will to serve others as he was a servant of all, who gave up his life and died for us, but lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please sit for the readings.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Lazarus said, I am Abraham's servant. The Lord has greatly blessed my master, and he has become wealthy. He has given him flocks and herds, silver and gold, male and female slaves, camels and donkeys. And Sarah, my master's wife, or a son to my master when she was old, and he has given him all of his house. My master made me swear, saying, you shall not take a wife for my son from the daughters of the Canaanites, in whose land I live, but you shall go to my father's house, to my kindred, and get a wife for my son. I came today to the spring and said, O Lord, the God of the master Abraham, if now you will only make successful the way I am going. I am standing here by the spring of water, but the young woman who comes to draw, whom I shall say, please give me a little water from your jar to drink, and who will say to me, drink, and I will draw for your camels also. Let her be the woman whom the Lord has appointed for my master's son. Before I had finished speaking in my heart, there was Rebecca coming out with her water jar on her shoulder, and she went down to the spring and drew. I said to her, please let me drink. She quickly let down her jar on her shoulder and said, drink, and I will also water your camels. So I drank, and she also watered the camels. Then I asked her, whose daughter are you? She said, daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son, whom Micah bore to him. So I put the ring on her nose and the bracelets on her arms. Then I bowed my head and worshipped the Lord and blessed the Lord, the God of my master Abraham, who had led me from by the right way to obtain the daughter of my master's kinsman for his son. Now then, you will feel loyalty and peace with my master. Tell me, and if not, tell me, so that I may either turn either to the right hand or to the left. And they called Rebecca and said to her, will you go with this man? She said, I will. So they sent away their sister Rebecca and her nurse, along with Abraham's servant and his men. And they blessed Rebecca and said to her, may you, our sister, become thousands of myriads. May your offspring gain possession of the gates of their foes. Then Rebecca and her maids rose up, mounted the camels, and followed the man. Thus the servant took Rebecca and went on his way. Now Isaac had come from Mahalara, and he settled in Negev. Isaac went out in the evening to walk in the field, and looking up, he saw camels come. And Rebecca looked up, and when she saw Isaac, she slipped quickly from the camel and said to the servant, who is this man over here, walking in the field to meet us? The servant said, it is my master. So she took her veil and covered herself. And the servant told Isaac all the things that he had done. And Isaac brought her into his mother's, Sarah's tent. He took Rebecca, and she became his wife, and he loved her. So Isaac was comforted after his mother's death.
Thanks be to God. generation to another. Therefore, nations will praise you forever and
I
Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus said, "To what will I compare this generation? It's like children sitting in the marketplace and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you didn't dance. We wailed, and you didn't mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds." At that time, Jesus said, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Don't respect their humanity and their person. is in a close enough relationship with us that they're willing to ask an intimate or personal or difficult question. And they rely on us for our honesty because they've come to us as a friend. And because we're not comfortable being honest, we don't give them the feedback they need or desire, possibly to help them make a really good decision the next time. So sometimes we tell people a white lie and encourage them to keep doing the thing that makes them neither attractive or successful because we haven't had the courage to be honest, because we couldn't handle our own feelings in that situation. We weren't thinking about the other person. We were just thinking about ourselves. Lies are just one type of sin, but we do them all the time, obviously. My friend here thinks we do them 500 times a week. Hopefully it's not that bad. But when we think about sin, the first thing that comes to mind are the big sins, the seven deadly sins. Does anybody know any of the seven deadly sins? Can anybody name any of them? Can you think of any? What?
Gluttony.
Gluttony. Gee, interesting, that's the one you chose. Gluttony.
Yeah.
No? That's just the Ten Commandments.
Lust.
Lust.
Pride.
Pride.
Jealousy.
Envy, yeah. Sloth. Covetousness, and there's one more. It's greed, yes. So when we think about those things, every one of those sins is actually a good thing. God has given us wants and needs and desires because he wants us to have what kind of a life?
Good.
A good life. He says in John, I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. He wants us to have abundant life, so he gives us needs and wants and desires. And they're natural human things that enable us to live into the image of God that he has created within us. Gluttony is just eating pushed too far, pushed beyond the boundary. We need to eat to sustain our bodies. If we didn't eat, what would happen to us?
Yeah.
Sloth. If you think about it, we all need rest. Jesus himself, we're told in scripture, took time away. He left his disciples, he went to find a place where he could lie down, where he could rest, where he could refresh, where he could recuperate. There's nothing wrong with stopping working, stopping doing, and simply having downtime. It refreshes our bodies, our minds, and our souls. But not to the extent that you spend all day prone with the converter. Honey, get me another drink. We've taken a good thing, a thing God intends for us, and just pushed it a bit too far. If we think about lust, desire is a natural human instinct. Humans were made to seek other human beings. If we didn't seek others, we wouldn't find ourselves in relationship. We wouldn't see families. We wouldn't see children. It is a natural and normal thing to desire another human being. But when we pursue that person when they've said no, when we make them the sole reason for which we get up and strive every day, so that we don't think about God, or we don't see them as a person anymore, we simply see them as an object, we have pushed a good and natural instinct too far. And so it goes. With envy, God wants us to be healthily competitive one with another, to be our best self by discovering things in others that we wish we could attain to. But if we spend every day and every night thinking, she shouldn't have that thing, he should have got that promotion, I'm better than them, I'm going to find a way to undermine them and prove it, it's a good thing pushed too far. So what is it? Paul says, why is it when I know what the right thing is to do,
I always do the wrong.
Paul likes to separate the sin from the sinner. He says, I want to do right, but there's something that causes me to do wrong. How am I going to overcome that? And Paul is right when he says, if you look at what he says to us today, he says, no matter how hard I try, it just seems like it's the rule that the thing I want to do, I can't do. Evil lies close at hand. In my innermost heart of hearts, I want to do the right thing, but somehow I do another thing. Who's going to save me from this? Who's going to rescue me from this? How does one rescue oneself in sin? As a start, as the only way. He says it at the end of this reading. Oh, thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Because that is the only way. Reconsidering the boundaries, the healthy and good boundaries God has set for us, and seeking to remain or to return within those boundaries through prayer, through acknowledging our sin. You have to own the sin to disown the sin. You know how it says in the scripture that we just say at the beginning of the Eucharist in our three sets of comfortable words. If we say we have no sin, yes, there is no health in us. We all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. So we begin by saying, that was a mistake. I shouldn't have spoken to her like that. I shouldn't have done that thing. I shouldn't have spent all day and night driving by the master showroom looking at that Miata. I'm just going to let it go. Why aren't I have a car? We have to own the sin, own our weakness, and own our inability to do anything about it without Jesus. If we think of what we consider the beginning of sin in the Garden of Eden, what was it that Adam and Eve did that was so wrong? They wanted one thing, but it was the one thing God knew wasn't healthy or good for them. So he said, you can have anything you want. This entire garden is yours. But what did they want? The one thing they couldn't have. They wanted to step beyond the boundaries of what would provide an abundant life and slip into sin. We need to recover within ourselves by acknowledging what we've done wrong, those boundaries that God has happily set for us so that we can have an abundant life. Jesus says, just be like a child. Just keep it simple. Don't try to come up with some crazy explanation for why it isn't your fault, it's someone else's fault. Because really the worst lies we tell are which? The ones we tell ourselves. We can convince ourselves we're right. Who of us gets into an argument and doesn't think we're absolutely right? Who of us doesn't think and doesn't believe we're absolutely right? So Jesus says, you have to come into my boundaries. Take on my yoke. You'll never follow all the rules. If I just keep looking at the rules and reading the law, I'll get it right. You have to leave that behind. But he doesn't say it's a free-for-all. He says, take on my yoke. And what is that yoke? What does he tell us? Be humble and be gentle. So in humility, we need to admit we've gone wrong. When we've wronged someone, when we've said an unkind thing, when we've deliberately tried to undermine and put someone else down, or try to do a thing, or convince someone to do a thing that really isn't in our or their best interests. It's so easy to say, I'm sorry. We teach our children to say it all the time, but when we're adults, well, that wasn't really my fault, or you should have done that, that wouldn't have happened. We need to be humble and admit, own the sin. I was wrong, I did a wrong thing, I said a wrong thing, I said an unkind thing, I made a mistake, I just made a mistake. And be gracious and accepting forgiveness. And then forgive yourself. If we stay within God's boundaries, if we acknowledge what we've strayed and really pray and ask Jesus to help us to get back on the right track, acknowledge that we have sinned and fallen short, there is a welcome and a forgiveness and an ease of mind available. Remember those participants in they studied at Notre Dame University. They found that if they consciously practiced not telling a lie, if they consciously practiced being truthful and forthright in all their dealings, they had lower blood pressure rates, lower heart rates, fewer headaches, fewer sore throats. Yes, your throat gets sore from telling a lot of lies, especially if you're telling 500 people. That's right. So we're throwing up. God wants us to have all the things that we desire. He wants us to have an abundant life. But he reminds us we can easily be yoked by sin when those desires go astray. Better to take on the yoke of Jesus, to be humble, to be gentle, and to happily lay our burdens on him. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our liturgy continues on page 189 as we stand and confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed, saying together, I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate,
was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Pray for peace throughout the world. The Lord will grant that we may live together in justice and peace.
Lord,
we pray for this country, especially for Elizabeth, our Queen, David, the Governor General, Justin, our Prime Minister, and all in authority. The Lord help them to serve this people according to His holy will.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We give thanks for our summer vacations as we pray for our children and young people, for their teachers, for their refreshment, that we may start a new year in September, continue our learning. That the Lord will guide their growth and development.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let's pray for the sick, remembering especially Doug Young, Audrey Lees, Meredith Fowler, Logan McKay, Penny Gallagher, Margaret French, Walter Youngworth, John Beck, Lee School, Tyson Nicola, Dave Wendell. The Lord will deliver them and keep them in his love.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let's pray for all who are condemned to exile, prison, harsh treatment, or hard labor. For the sake of justice and truth, Lord, support them and keep them steadfast.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We remember the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and all who have borne witness to the gospel. The Lord, direct our lives in the same spirit of service and sacrifice.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Gracious God, you have heard the prayers of your faithful people. You know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Grant our requests may be best for us. This we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Continue on page 191, dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to his table. Let us confess our sins confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we sin against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we mourn in your name. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may be in the light of your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said to his disciples, my peace I give to you, my peace I leave with you. Not as the world gives, give I unto you. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another in the peace.
Thank you.
He is your living word through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who place their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of evil and death and banish the darkness of sin and despair. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. Now, with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Remember, therefore, his death and resurrection, we offer you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send the Holy Spirit upon the offering of your holy church, gathering to one all who share these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant Jesus Christ. All glory and honor are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Church, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our sentence for the fraction, for the breaking of the bread, is sentence number 3. Creator of all, you gave us golden fields of wheat, whose many grains we have gathered and made into this one bread.
So may the church have gathered from the ends of the earth into your kingdom.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are they who are called to the supper of the Lamb, the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
shared in holy things, never fail to serve you in your world, and so come to the fullness of joy. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Will you join me in saying a prayer along with page 214? All members praise you, O Lord.
And to your faithful servants and us,
gracious God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ.
May we who share his body, live his life, we who drink his cup, bring life to us. We who spare lives, give life to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live praise and reign. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Be steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and untiring in love all the days of your life. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and those you love, here and in paradise, now and forever. Are there any announcements this morning? Does anyone have an announcement which needs to be made? I have a few. First of all, please note when we enter or exit the church, there are some board day-by-days and some Anglicans there that, I don't mean Anglicans as in too late, but I mean as in the newspaper, that are there for your taking. So if you would like a change in your daily devotions or an aid to your daily devotions, I use four day by day every day, and I really find it helpful to me. They're free and they're available on the back table. There's some large print or little smaller pocket ones. If you would like these, help yourself. Thank you for our flowers, our flower provider from today. Who brought the flowers in? Beautiful, as usual. Very straight up from your garden. You didn't steal them from someone else's garden. Beautiful, lovely. If you would like to give flowers and you would like them to be acknowledged as a memorial or a thank offering, please let us know during the week and we'll make sure that that memorial or thank offering gets put into the bulletin. Looking far ahead, our annual cemetery service is coming up on April the 13th at 2:30.
August.
Did I say April?
April.
Far, far away. That is far ahead. On August, I'm sorry. On August the 13th at 2:30, we will be having our service at the cemetery on that day. We will not be having a service here at the church. We will be having a service at the cemetery at 2:30. So I encourage you to come and join us at that time to remember those from our parish and those from our community who have gone on to rest in the loving arms of our Lord, to celebrate the history of our presence in this community and the importance of that cemetery in the life of our community. So mark that on your calendar. Remember, on the 13th at 2:30, we will all be gathering at the old church over the cemetery. I am hoping, though not promising, that I've read the building inspection report, and I'm going to have a look through the old church and see if it's not too unsafe. We might be able to have the building open that day for those of you who might like to have a little walk around inside. So just keep that date and tell anybody who isn't here today or maybe is away but might be coming back in August that on the 13th we're all going to be celebrating the history of our presence in this community over at the cemetery. Any other announcements?
Just a reminder about the parish advisory board on Thursday at 2 o'clock in the afternoon.
Was there something wrong with your old seat?
It's too hot in here. I need the air conditioning.
When our liturgy started, he was over there. Now he's over there. You're confusing me. Anglicans always sit in the same place all the time. Don't mess me up like that. Would you like to stand up so everyone can hear you make your announcement?
Yes. Let's say advisory board meeting this Thursday, 2 o'clock. It's an afternoon meeting, so that means.